Why does vitamin B12 damaged by nitrous oxide require megadosed folic acid rather than normal levels of natural folate?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Okay, Jeff Huseby says, I was reading a study on PubMed about a man who had a B12 deficiency because of nitrous oxide abuse. Interesting. After megadosing B12 under doctor supervision, his symptoms worsened. After testing normal for blood folate, his doctor determined that a folate trap must be occurring. Okay. His symptoms greatly improved after 2 weeks of megadosing both B12 and folic acid. Their conclusions perplexed me, however. I understand how methylfolate can be trapped by not having enough B12 to transfer its methyl group. Correct. But why would supplementing with B12 not resolve the problem when blood folate is normal? Well, so this is me interjecting. Serum folate is mostly methylfolate, and it's not testing anything intracellularly, but it's generally going to be reflective of the intracellular methylfolate supply. And trapped, the methyl trap is the trapping of folate as methylfolate. So the serum folate's not really going to be relevant. I'll look at that. I see you posted the link, so I'll take a look at it. But the first thing that you said doesn't make any sense, that because the serum folate was normal, there must be a folate trap. That doesn't make sense. I mean, there could be a folate trap, but the mere fact that serum folate is normal doesn't tell you that. The mere fact that serum folate is normal doesn't tell you that there's not a methyl trap going on. It really doesn't tell you anything about whether there's a methyl trap going on. Okay, going back to Jeff's question, why can B12 only access megadosed folic acid but not normal levels of folate? I don't know what that means. Why can B12 only access megadosed folic acid but not normal levels of folate? I'm not sure what you mean by that sentence, Jeff. Furthermore, they reasoned that the folic acid was needed to reverse the neurological symptoms of B12 deficiency because it was able to methylate the DNA needed for myelin sheath synthesis through 5-10-MTHF, which they said was the active methyl donor for DNA. What? I thought 5-MTHF was the methyl donor for DNA and everything else. I think there's some confusion in terminology going on here, but let me share my screen and show you I'll show you folate metabolism first, and then we'll take a look at that case report. All right, let me bring up a diagram of folate metabolism. It'll take a second. Interesting. So folate's going from tetrahydrofolate to dihydrofolate after donating the CH2. So it's reducing the CH2 to a CH3. Okay. So the answer to your question is that reaction is not a true methylation reaction. It's adding a methyl group in a two-step process of donating a methylene group and then reducing it to a methyl group. So what we did was we took the carbon from the methylene part right here, and then we took this hydrogen from THF, we went to DHF, and we added that hydrogen to complete the methyl group. So it's not a methylation reaction. It's a two-step methylation reaction, followed by a second reduction of the methylene group to to a methyl group. But that's sort of like, you know, it's sort of like saying, because MTHFD1 can take THF and make it 10-formyl THF by adding a carbon, and then 5-10-methenyl THF by adding a hydrogen, and then 5-10-methylene THF by adding a hydrogen again, and then set that up for MTHFR to turn that into a methyl group. It's sort of like saying MTHFD1 is a methylator, or MTHFR is a methylator. It's not. You didn't methylate folate. You formulated folate, and then you reduced it, and then you reduced it, and then you reduced it. That's why MTHFR is called a reductase and not a methyltransferase. So they call that a methylation. It's because a methyl group does get added to the thymidylate, but it's not a methylation reaction. It's a sequential methylation followed by reduction reaction. Okay, so I'm sorry this was so long-winded, but stop share. Okay. Okay, so Jeff Huseby follows up. The B12 didn't work until it was paired with megadosed folic acid, is what I mean by why can B12 only access megadosed folic acid but not normal levels of folate? I don't know. Let me take a look at this. So I'm going to share my screen again. And we're looking at this 2020 paper in Curious, not curious like wondering, but anyway, nitrous oxide induced posterior cord myelopathy. Beware of the methylfolate trap. All right, let's take a look at what happened. So posterior cord myelopathy and subacute combined degeneration of the spinal cord are well-known complications of nitrous oxide abuse. Supplementation with vitamin B12 is an effective treatment strategy to correct low serum B12 levels or normal serum levels of dysfunctional B12 associated with this pathology. In this case, we report a patient with a one-year history of heavy nitrous oxide consumption, anywhere from 8 to 30 canisters of 8 grams of nitrous oxide daily. The patient's symptoms worsened after the institution megadoses of vitamin B12, despite normal serum folate levels. This can be explained by the phenomenon of the methylfolate trap and warrants prompt supplementation with synthetic folate. We discussed the biochemistry of nitrous oxide toxicity and underlying mechanisms. Let's see if they have a diagram of their hypothesis. So they're saying that nitrous oxide is going to deplete vitamin B12. That makes sense because it's vulnerable to oxidation. And so that's going to block. So if you don't have vitamin B12 available, then you will have a methyl. Yeah, I mean, that makes sense, right? So if nitrous oxide depletes B12, you have a methyl trap because the 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate cannot give up its methyl group to B12. So normally what happens is the 5-methyl THF gives up its methyl group to B12 to make methylcobalamin, which then methylates homocysteine to become methionine. Meanwhile, the 5-methyl THF becomes THF. And if we go back to this diagram of folate, we went into small mode. If you trap everything as 5-methyl THF and it can't go anywhere else and you never generate THF, then you're not ever going to be able to use that folate to make 5-10-methylene THF to use for DNA synthesis. So that's the logic of the methyl trap. All right. So I mean that part makes sense. And then I guess, would that imply that you need to megadose folic acid? Well, the issue is if you're supplementing with 5-MTHF and you have a severe methyl trap, then you will never be able to convert that 5-methyl THF to THF to 5-10-methylene THF. So it does make sense that if you're trying to reverse that methyl trap, you want folic acid, because if we go back to folate metabolism, that folic, well, this doesn't have, this diagram doesn't have the conversion of folic acid to THF, but what happens is you have an enzyme DHFR that converts DHF to THF after you make thymidylate, and folic acid can be processed by DHFR to become DHF, and then it can be processed again to turn the DHF to THF. So if you take folic acid, it's going to go through DHF twice and become THF, and then all of a sudden that THF can be formulated, reduced twice to 5-10-methylene-THF, and can be used for DNA synthesis. Whereas if you put 5-methyl-THF in, you know, under normal circumstances, it can give up the methyl group to make methylcobalamin, and then it becomes THF, just like the folic acid would. But under methyl trap circumstances, you would not be able to use 5-MTHF for that, because it would get stuck as 5-MTHF, and you would need to use something else. And so folic acid is one thing you could use. I don't see why you couldn't use like folinic acid. You just can't use methylfolate. All right. So I guess your question though was, why didn't the B12 itself free up the methyl trap? That's a valid puzzling statement. So, let's see, I don't want to read the whole thing here because we've spent so much time on it already. But patient serology had 42 homocysteine. That's massive. Methylmalonic acid was several times the top of the reference range. It was like six times. Is it six? Five times the top of the reference range. And this probably isn't folic acid levels. It's probably methylfolate levels, but serum folate was not that great, but in the normal range, in the middle of the normal range. Okay. So patient was started on 5 milligram megadoses of sublingual vitamin B12 daily. 4 days later, he started experiencing the Lermit phenomenon, which he described as a powerful tingling vibration that traveled down the arms, trunk, legs, and continued all the way down to the feet, elicited by neck flexion. The phenomenon was also elicited by elevating his arms and you know, so one, I mean, one thing that could be possible is that if the folate wasn't really, so, you know, it's quite possible the methyl folate was normal, but the methylene folate and all the other forms were severely depleted. In that case, it seems possible that the B12 and that the methylation reactions were downregulated as a result of failure to use the methyl folate for anything. And so it's seems possible that the B12 would upregulate the methylation reactions. And even though it should be freeing up the folate, it's actually, by turning up the volume on methylation, it's actually taking more folate into that thing, into the methylation reactions, and kind of stealing it away from DNA synthesis. That does seem conceivable. Anyway, 4 days later, he started getting powerful tingling vibration, traveled down the arms, trunk, legs, and continued all the way down the feet, elicited by neck flexion. The phenomenon was also elicited by elevating his arms, was prominent in the interior abdomen. He described an electrifying sensation. We immediately instituted large dose of folic acid supplementation at a dose of 4 milligrams daily, and his diffuse numbness, including that phenomenon, stopped worsening after 5 days. May improve slightly, but persist. The patient continues on 5 milligram megadose of sublingual B12 and 4 milligrams folic acid daily. Noteworthy, his mood and mental fogginess has improved. His irritability dissipated and his mental clarity normalized. All right. I spent enough time on this. I'm going to give you my final thoughts. So what they did was they did one thing for 4 days, it got worse. They did another thing, and in 5 days, it got better. So there's no way on earth that they wouldn't know that after a week, it wouldn't have gotten better anyway. But one plausible explanation is that not only did they have a methyl trap, but they had a transient downregulation of methylation reactions, which reversed when they started supplementing the B12. And because of that reversal, the freeing up of the folate from the methyl trap was not adequate to compensate for the fact that upregulating the methylation system drove more folate into it. And so they might have converted the methyl trap into a folate vacuum. And I don't think they needed folic acid, but they need a non-methylfolate form. And folic acid is an easily available thing. I suspect folinic acid probably would have worked. I don't think we can say with 100% confidence that the folic acid is what reversed it, but I think it's totally plausible that it did for the reasons I just described. Okay, so sorry I took so long on that, but hope that helped.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.